Laser 558 News, filling a much-needed void. The VGI blockade is going into its fourth week, and there's more egg on the VGI and IBA's faces than the EEC has surplus potatoes. The publicity generated for offshore stations is incredible. It's not just amazing. It's not just a farce. It's not just chopped liver. It's
Euro Siege 85.
Cute we've been, and watching the detectives we will. This is Charlie Wolf. Laser 558 News has spared no expense to give you the fullest coverage of Euro Siege 85 possible. And now, at a cost of 50,000 lira a month, we've leased a high-speed surveillance boat from Calamity House, the Laser News Cruiser. It'll be on assignment visiting the Ross Revenge to see how they're coping, and I'll also visit the Deontic Surveyor with our portable news-gathering equipment for a special interview. Be listening for special reports from the field tomorrow on Euro Siege 85 Updates, exclusively from the station that puts its reputation on the line, Laser 558.
The arrival of the new Radio Caroline ship in August 1983 was a welcome surprise to many offshore radio supporters. Even more so was the arrival of the MV Communicator in 1984. Its fast, slick programming and diet of American top 40 format music made it an instant success in the southeast of England and ate into large percentages of ILR audience listening figures. Something had to be done. Discussions between the IBA, Home Office, Police and Department of Trade and Industry during early 1985 led to a full ship-based mobile surveillance unit. On the 8th of August, the Department of Trade and Industry chartered the Dioptric Surveyor from Trinity House to monitor the stations. During the surveillance, we visited both Radio Caroline and Laser 558 to make this in-depth report. Our first stop was Radio Caroline, where it was very much business as usual.
Tim Harding, first of all, reason to believe. And then we heard Steel Eye Span, Hard Times for Old England. If you'd like to write into this section of the programme, the address is Coffee Time, Radio Caroline, International, New York, 11518 in the USA. And we'll tie up this morning's programme with an instrumental from Chris Rea, who's not normally noted for his instrumentals, so you don't often hear this track, but I thought it was quite appropriate. It's called Friends Across the Water. We've enjoyed it, actually. They've given us no particular trouble. We did get in touch. Well, we did ask, call them on the VHF, but they didn't answer. No, not at all. No, they're not answering anybody. In fact, they've had a fair bit of traffic. A number of people from the press have been calling them up from shore, and they haven't answered anybody. I would imagine that eventually they'll go away.
It's getting closer and more spectacular every day.
It's been quite interesting with new visitors in the vicinity. Very interesting indeed, you know. At first when they came out, which was, I think, Thursday the 9th, something like that, they sailed past very close. You know, they're obviously taking photograph and film footage of everybody on board and the ship. They sailed past within about 10 feet, 10-15 feet, but we waved to them. At first they didn't even wave back, but as the days went on, they kept just going between us and the communicator laser. And eventually we saluted them, just went like that. They saluted back, and the last time they came past, we actually sort of waved and they waved. So it's got a little bit more friendly, but they're obviously doing a job, and that's it, you know. They've been here since Wednesday, and this is, what, Monday. So they've been here since Wednesday and haven't been into port. But at first, the first few days, they were here for like 6 hours, and then they would disappear to the northeast of us, which obviously meant they were going into Harwich. But the Dioptric Surveyor has not been the only boat that's been on station here. Last Monday, we had the Trinity House vessel, the Farn. That was here for a few hours. But the first couple of days, they weren't here all the time. They were just here at daylight, nighttime, they weren't here at all. But since Wednesday, they've been permanently anchored there. Since they've been here, we've had boats every day, and it's great. I mean, it's just nice to see people during the week. And they're obviously coming out to see the Dioptric Surveyor, take photographs of them, as well as coming here. I mean, if anything, it's helped us. I mean, everybody on board is in very high spirits, no problems at all. But nobody's broken any laws, from what I can see. I mean, no, you know, it's only illegal for these boats that come out here from Britain to put newspapers and food on board. It's not illegal for them to circle round our ship. All they can really do, the Dioptric Surveyor this is report the presence of boats that come out here. That's all they can do, and maybe if somebody does supplies, then there will be problems, but certainly nobody's broken the law as far as I can see. From the reaction we've had from the boats that come out here with the so-called anoraks on board, they're the people who listen to us and hire boats to come out here, we've never seen as many boats as we've seen this weekend, and they've all been packed solid, and they've all been urging us to go on and not to give up. And we're not going to give up. We're going to stay here. I mean, if anything, that boat over there is making life more easier for us because we are now getting more contact. They might be monitoring our transmissions, but, well, fair enough. We've got more listeners if they're monitoring the transmissions, you know. All the more for us. Just occasionally say, here's one for the Dioptric Surveyor. And that's it. We keep it like that. There's no point in doing anything silly like calling them morons or anything like that, because they're only doing the job.
Radio Caroline was celebrating their 21st birthday in 1985, and there was a strong feeling that after 21 years, it was going to take more than a surveillance vessel to get them off the air. Our trip across to the MV Communicator was a little more eventful. Whilst we were filming on the Caroline ship, the Dioptric's crew had radioed to the Essex Police, who sent this vessel, the Alert 3, to intercept us. The vessel was to just circle us at close quarters for a couple of minutes and then disappear. In contrast to Caroline's low-key approach to Eurosiege, Laser were the complete opposite. It could be argued that Laser went more out of their way to wind up the DTI, as the following clearly indicates.
Show your support of Laser 558 and pick up a copy of I Spy for the DTI on Parse Records. Purchase the single or get the extended Whitehall Dance Mix. With the record, you'll receive a picture bag with a full
Laser 558 keeps you up to date every day on Eurosiege 85. Eurosiege updates live from our vantage point on the poop deck of the MV Communicator.
Daily reports.
Exciting day. We actually got a glimpse of some of the guys from the
in-depth background features.
The Dioptric Surveyor, it's not an ocean-going vessel.
And all of our fast news gathering resources.
Eurosiege updates daily at 1:30 and 5:30 British time from the station that doesn't schnooze on news. Laser 558.
Wow! Come out and see the offshore radio stations with Anorak's DTI.
Anorak's DTI, Europe's largest free radio organization, with scheduled tours of the ships every 3 days. More trips than anybody else. Our charter boat, the Dioptric Surveyor, is sleek, has lots of radar, and the crew dresses real nice with uniforms and ties. Best of all, the boat is small, not really cut out for open seas, so it bounces around a lot. We promise you'll feel all the swashbuckling fun of being at sea. You may even throw up. Of course, we can't promise that, but many who've taken our trips have tossed their cookies. The staff of Anorak's DTI will help you in getting the best photos and answer your questions about offshore radio. No one knows more about offshore radio than Anorak's DTI. Schedule your trip today and check out our catalog of great products, including an extensive choice of candid photos. Ring Anorak's DTI today at our offices in the IBA building, London. Remember, everyone's an Anorak at heart, and at 50,000 quid a month, we've got to pay for this somehow. Anorak's DTI.
Available September 23rd in your record shop, the Moronic Surveyors and I Spy for the DTI. Let's go out to the poop deck right now with Charles Wolf. And what's happening, Chuck?
Thank you, Tommy. It's day 36 of Eurosiege 85. And as I survey the scene, I don't see the surveyor. The Moronic Surveyor left earlier today, bugged off in bad weather or something or other, but the coast is clear at the present time, Tommy. From what I understand, we had a boat come by, the Gray Echo come by earlier.
Yep.
Uh-huh, and the guys waved at us, and they were sure nice, and from what we understand, the Moronic Surveyor should be coming back soon. We'll go up to the electronic monitoring station on the bridge of the MV Communicator and check out the scene there, of course, and keep our eyes open for the Moronic Surveyor.
They picked up their spy mail, too, Charlie.
Oh, I heard. They got, thank you. And we want to thank everybody that's been writing to the boys on the spy boat. You can still send in more letters, and what we may do is deliver them to Fleet Street in the future, okay, and have them deliver it out to the spy boat. But they did get their first shipment of mail today. Some real nice letters. We got a chance to go through some of them. Of course, we opened their mail because it came to our ship.
We can do whatever we want. We're anarchists, remember?
But they got their mail. I got a hatch door here that's flying all over the place. My word. But they got their mail this morning, Tommy.
Yep.
Stay, door, stay. This door is coming at me, Tommy.
Doesn't like you.
I know. It don't like me. Get back there.
There you.
Hear that? No. Kick it. There you go. All right. They got their mail. I said that, didn't I? Got their mail this morning, and I want to thank everybody for the letters. If you want to send them some more stuff, which I said we'll deliver to Fleet Street to have them deliver, send it to the Boys on the Spy Boat, P.O. Box 1828, Grand Central Station in New York City. Postcode is 10163. That's pretty much the scene out here, Tommy. It's been your usual boring day, a good tax dollar wasting day, don't you think, Tom?
Mm-hmm. At least.
Really. All righty, well, that's the scene out here. The next scheduled Euro Siege update is whenever it happens. This is Charlie Wolf reporting live from the poop deck of the MV Communicator.
You know what they say at the DTI, Charlie?
What's that, Tom?
The heat is on.
You got it, baby.
All right.
We're going to bust them Americans.
In October 1985, the Department of Trade and Industry organized two press conferences, one in Maidstone, Kent, and one in Chelmsford, Essex, to put forward the DTI's claim.
The work of the Radio Investigation Service is to regulate the whole radio spectrum and to ensure that it's properly patrolled and licensed and that there is a minimal amount of interference between services. There are now 1 million users of radio in this country. They're crammed into a finite spectrum, and it is part of our job to make sure that everybody has a fair crack of the whip and that they're able to communicate via radio without interference. Now, we do this work, it's not just a British government job, we're part of the International Telecommunications Union, which reaches international concordats on various radio frequencies and allocations for various users of radio. And we're talking here not just about the broadcast medium, the Radio 4 and perhaps local Radio Essex, we're talking about the whole multitudinous users of the spectrum, from taxi drivers, ambulance, police, fire brigades, ship-to-ship communication, ground-to-air communication, and all the many uses of radio. Now, our job in making sure that we have interference-free radio is made unnecessarily complicated when we have people charging in who don't subject themselves to any authority at all but broadcast outside the law. And we're talking, of course, in this case, the purpose of this conference, we're talking about radios Laser and Caroline. Now, it's our purpose to illustrate to you today that we're not being government killjoys, hard-faced, trying to clamp down on the undoubted enjoyment that many kids in this country get out of pirate radio. That's not our job at all. The content of pirate radio broadcasts or the way they're funded isn't really part of our interest. It is our interest to make sure that pirate radio stations are off the air, because not only do they represent a serious nuisance in the way they break into and interrupt ordinary broadcast services, such as locally we have Invicta Radio at Canterbury. We've had interference with local campus radios and others, which we'll be illustrating later on in the conference. But they also present a serious, major and continuing threat to human life, in that they frequently interrupt emergency broadcast channels and also cause interference problems to marine and aeronautical navigational beacons. We haven't had a tragedy yet, but the winter coming on, and as time progresses, the chances of radio interference causing an avoidable tragedy by jamming out the emergency frequencies and simple radio beacons grows.
Although the basic argument against pirate radio sounds fairly convincing, the Department of Trade and Industry officials went to great lengths to give complex examples of how interference to authorized broadcasts could take place. The main theme of the press conference seemed to play on the conscious of mind threat by claiming that pirate radio was a danger to life. Our various radio experts who have studied our video footage have all agreed that the DTI claims are based on hypothetical instances. In reality, it would be highly unlikely that any interference could occur, let alone endanger life. The DTI team made several statements of fact about the offshore stations, which were totally wrong, and primarily set about confusing the audience, who were made up of mainly press reporters, who were very easily baffled with technical figures and jargon. During all examples illustrated, great use of the words if, maybe, and can were made.
There is another problem that occurs. You've got this fundamental, you've got these harmonics, and you've got these that can arise on laser, that can arise on Caroline. And these can all mix together mathematically. It's, the system is known as intermodulation products. Suffice it to say that this mixing can occur to produce other frequencies again. And these can occur either aboard the transmitter, on the transmitter aboard the ship, such that those frequencies, these odd frequencies, spurious, the unwanted ones, are radiated through the air, or they can occur in a receiver aboard a yacht that's trying to, say, deep direction find its way off the sunk light beacon to get into Harwich Harbour, in fog, for example. So you can have this mixing occurring at the transmitter end or at the receiver end. And the mixing can become extremely complicated indeed. In fact, you need a computer program to work it all out. Now, let me just give very simple examples of how this mixing, take the argument, can cause problems. We've got Monique on 963. And if you take away from that the Caroline on 576, you get a new frequency transmitted, 387. 387 is very, very close to 386. From a normal receiver point of view, no difference. And that is actually a North Sea rig, NDB. NDB is non-directional beacon. It's the aeronautical beacons used on these rigs for helicopters homing in. So by that simple process, you can actually produce a frequency which jams out that aeronautical beacon. 387 is also very, very close to 389.5, and that's the beacon of Heathrow. One would consider that Heathrow might be a very important beacon. Another example, and these are very, very simple examples, I must state. You've got here Monique from Fundamental on 963 minus the BBC World Service on 648. The BBC World Service is broadcast from Orford Ness, which is on the coast, quite adjacent to where they sit in Carolina. And it's a very, very powerful station indeed. It's 2 megawatts. These two stations, Carolina and Laser, of the order of 50 kilowatts. So Orfordness is a very, very powerful station. So if you take the Monique Fundamental of 963, subtract from it the 648, the World Service, and you get a frequency of 315 kilohertz, which is actually the sunk light vessel which is at the entrance to Harwich Harbour and is used by small boats. Let me make a point here that we're talking about direction finding these beacons from small boats, yachts. They have receivers on there which are obviously at the lower end of the price market. We're not talking about the same sort of equipment which is aboard the very, very large ships which are fitted out, for example, by Marconi's. And I'm an ex-Marconi man and know their equipment very well. That's very, very high quality equipment to a very, very high performance specification, has to be rigidly tested, and that doesn't suffer from certain problems. These small receivers aboard these yachts can suffer from certain problems. Two sets of beacons throughout the whole of the North Sea that use these two frequencies here, 553.5, 579.5, which correspond to Laser and Caroline. In other words, those two radio stations can sit almost on top of those two beacons in radio terms and block them out. And we have had examples of complaints through to us where helicopter pilots have said, I'm sorry, I can't pick up the beacon on the oil platform I'm homing in on because I'm picking up Duran Duran.
How long has the vessel been there now, the spy ships?
What, the Dark Trick Surveyor?
Yes.
It's been there since early in August.
I've seen a figure somewhere of costing about £50,000 a week to keep it on station, is that right?
No, that's grossly exaggerated.
What does it look like?
I think it's about 25,000 a month.
How long are you prepared to have it sitting there, 25,000?
Well, this is a ministerial decision. The ministers decided to put it out. They review the situation every now and again to see how it's getting on and whether it's justified. But I think it is a measure of the importance that the government does attach to the problem of broadcasting at sea, that they are keeping that one out there. We can't say when it will stop.
How many people have they actually caught?
Well, they're not actually trying to catch anyone, you see. What they are doing is really giving help to the police in monitoring who goes out there, who appears to be involved in supplying the ships, because supply is an offence under the Marine Broadcasting Act. They give all this information to the police. The police interview people or intercept them on their way back and put cases to the Director of Public Prosecution.
In general, the DTI press conferences were hailed as a success in getting a good deal of public awareness and media coverage, both nationally and locally, in favour of their claims.
Comes into Laser's charts about a week ago at number 30, moved all the way up to 23 in 1 week. Now you might be asking, Chris, how do you know all that? Well, of course, I'm the one that does Laser chart action. That happens at Wednesday night, 5 o'clock in Britain, 6 o'clock in the continent. That's kind of a little hint for you to tune us in, okay? Music from The Boss coming up next. Don't you go away.
Gary Newman. The Laser programs during Euro Siege 85 were arguably at a peak, and the DTI surveillance had instigated a spate of take-offs, mickey-taking, that made compulsive listening. The Laser tenders from the UK were being plagued by the DTI surveillance, although a few were getting through. At this point, some careful management planning of supply vessels from the continent with food, fuel and water, and spare generator and transmitter parts could have prolonged Laser's life a lot more. Laser's costs of operation were always a lot higher than that of Caroline. The station had professionally obtained presenters from all markets in the US and undertook to provide travel expenses, wages, and all the usual trappings of full company expenses. By closing the Madison Avenue, New York sales office and trimming other expenses, Laser's running costs had been cut from well over £100,000 a month to about £30,000. But this was still not good enough, as the following weeks were to prove.
Lister 558 is your new music connection, and we are rocking with Sister Sledge, dancing on a jagged edge.
That's right, it's my night. It's the night of the seawolf, night of 1,000 seawolves. With, of course, a starring role, yours truly, the one and only, the humble Charles Wolfe, in a cast of 1,000 idiots being played by the Dioptric Surveyor. It's our DTI friends. 9 o'clock, it's 10 on the continent. And this is the one and only Laser 558.
At this point, it was starting to show that Laser would soon fold. Lack of fuel, low food supplies, lack of generator spares, crew and DJ wages overdue, discrepancies in advertising revenues. The signs were all there. Laser's days were numbered. And it can be easily argued that she would have folded anyway, with or without the DTI surveillance. The regular on-air staff, including Charlie Wolfe, Chris Carson, Liz West, Tommy Rivers, Joe Nell, Erin Kelly, were all to quit and be replaced by a new team in a desperate attempt to keep going and survive. Even refinancing and takeover bids were looked into. But no. The end finally came when on the 6th of November 1985, after a storm and a total generator failure, the captain negotiates with the DTI officials on the Guardline tracker to bring the vessel into Harwich Harbour. In a long, slow journey in, the MV Communicator, under her own steam, makes her way northeast along the Knock Deep and then west into Harwich Harbour, escorted by the Guardline tracker.
The offshore radio ship MB Communicator, home of Laser 558, sailed from the Knock Deep Channel today, escorted by the British government surveillance vessel Guardline tracker. The communicator had been plagued by generator problems since yesterday, and after a night of heavy storms on the North Sea, the government vessel took up position alongside the ship earlier today.
a Trinity House pilot is put on board the MV Communicator to help safely bring the radio ship into harbour. In the meantime, fans, press and media were converging on Harwich for the arrival of the radio ship. And as for the media, well, they had a field day.
Have you actually got a bit of a mutiny on your hands? That's the understanding we've
got
to believe.
Not at all, no. I visited the ship last night. There's neither a mutiny nor any cases of disease, as has been reported. The question in our minds is the status of the ship in terms of its seaworthiness.
Now, are you, in fact, happy that you are free yourself to gain access to the ship whenever you wish?
I expect that.
We had heard stories, of course, that, in fact, you had been denied access and the crew and the DJs were demanding that they actually receive payments which they claim they're owed.
There was no such demand when I visited the ship for about an hour last night.
So are, in fact, the difficulties that are being faced purely technical ones?
Primarily technical, yes.
Are the crew themselves and the DJs free to come aboard, come on British soil if they wish?
That's what we were told by the customs officials, but they recommended that the disc jockeys wait for immigration officials as well, who are expected today.
Now, what about the police and the Department of Trade and Industry? I mean, have they not been questioning all those aboard?
I think they have. Yes, I wasn't present for any of the questioning.
Have you been led to believe that there may be some reports with a view to prosecutions?
Not at all.
And what's the situation now as far as the future of Laser is concerned?
I can't tell you that.
Do you think there's a chance of the station actually going back on the air eventually?
I don't know.
Does it look pretty grim from a management point of view today?
It doesn't look as good as it did a few days ago.
The ship was to anchor at Ewerton Point in the River Stour, where, surprisingly, the crew were in good spirits and very protective.
We've heard stories of shortages of food, illness,
well,
mutiny.
I'm the cook, so I should have known.
You call that shortage of food?
No way.
So those stories are untrue, are they?
Definitely untrue. As you know, you press men, you add little bits on. Where you get it from, I don't know.
Did Laser offer you help when you reported the generator failure? We don't understand why you had to come in. And it's not been made clear to us by anyone why...
The repair's done.
To get the repairs done. Why couldn't they be done out there?
You get your boats, go out there and see what the conditions are like.
Is that the only problem you've been facing, just the generators?
Just the generators.
What about conditions and morale aboard?
Morale, happy. Happy-go-lucky. None of us have got bruises, black eyes or nothing.
There have been stories, though, and it has been admitted by the Laser management that a lot of people haven't been paid.
Well, that's news to me, mate.
You're all happy with the pay and conditions that the management are offering, are you?
At the moment, nothing to be said at the moment. As soon as everything has been organised, I've got everybody on board here, the DTI, everybody got sorted out, which is a lot of involvement, which is paperwork, as you understand. When we come ashore, you'll know about it, and then you can get the lot then.
Are you the skipper?
Yeah.
Will you be able to come ashore today, do you think?
Well, I'm hoping to get ashore today, because I want to make one or two phone calls myself.
Uh-huh. Laser say they're not best pleased about the ship being brought in. What's your reaction to that?
Well, that's their opinion. That's their opinion and my opinion, isn't it?
Well, you're the master. You're in charge of the ship, are you not?
Opinion, that's true. And Chris, and I'm in charge of the ship plus the crew, and their lives at my risk.
We're lives at risk because of the generator breakdown.
Well, mainly, well, not mainly that. No, no lives were at risk. At all times, we've got a tender, as you can see. There's always somebody there. There is always the Caroline if anything went bad, which we could have got aboard of. But I'm just there to mainly to keep the ship on the station and keep everything all under order and mainly make sure that everything's okay with the ship, which is it.
Have you had shortages, though, of food and fuel
because
of the DTI surveillance?
No, sir, nothing whatsoever.
So that hasn't been a problem?
We've just been hammered by the DTI at all, but they've never been aboard, which they are not allowed to. But any troubles whatsoever has been zero about that.
There's also been reports of dysentery and scurvy on board.
Well, if you go to these foreign countries on holiday, as obvious you're going to expect to get these diseases, and that's where she got it from.
So
and
no...
if you're a woman, you get more than that.
So how's morale amongst the DJs?
DJs are all happy.
Are they all prepared to go back out and start broadcasting if
the ship's... Yes, if we could go now, as soon as we can get the repairs done.
So if the ship is allowed to leave the port...
That's true.
...the DJs will be prepared to go back and start broadcasting again?
By all means.
Do you think that's likely, or are you going to have your new Brits put on you?
Well, no Ad Brits, nothing. The masks are all there. There's no Brits on them.
Your problems now are with immigration and the DTI, is that correct?
Is it? I don't know. My problem is getting the engine run up. Getting repairs.
Right.
I should be a shore lady. I should be in... Anyhow.
We don't know your name. What's your name?
Paternoster.
Sorry?
Paternoster.
Paternoster.
Our Father in the Bible. Don't you read the Bible?
Not regularly. I'm sorry.
Paternoster.
As you're so familiar with it, how do you spell it?
Paternoster.
Paternoster. And what's your first name?
Patrick.
Patrick Paternoster.
Church of England. Not right. Irish.
So who have you just sent ashore?
Nobody. I sent nobody ashore.
Some people waving at us from the back of the police launch.
Well, I hope he knows them. Maybe the police wave if you want to get on telly, I reckon.
Is there any of the DJs we can have a word with?
No, mate. Not at the moment.
Are they not allowed to talk to us?
That is correct.
Why? Who's preventing them? Is it a DTI or an immigration?
Well, we just want to keep everything to ourselves at the moment, because as you know, the information you've been getting has all been false. I only wish I could meet the people and they could say it face to face to me. Because, as the cook, I'll tell you, we've had none of this trouble whatsoever.
There's been no illness aboard, is that
no
what
illness,
say?
No.
Which one's the cook?
That is the gospel truth, I swear on anybody's life.
You're the cook.
Yeah.
What kind of sailors were the DJs on this trip?
Good.
Good sailors. No seasickness, no nothing.
Have there been problems, though, Mr. Cook, with the shortages of food or anything of that nature?
We weren't starved, by any chance. We had just fresh veg and meat.
So it's not been a case of the DTI surveillance starving you out?
Definitely not, no. No, we had plenty of food to survive. And there's been no disruption and no food poisoning.
So those rumours are definitely unfounded?
Well, I think they were put about by the ex-DJs that used to be on here. And they've got a grudge in for the station, probably because they couldn't get their money or something. But obviously it paid off because this West quite a bit out of her interest. But it was all lies.
So is morale really fairly good amongst people on board?
Oh, absolutely, yeah. It's true.
And would
if we could get back out there, we would.
If you were allowed by the authorities to go, would you have to come back on the air?
I've already said that to the governor, I would go with it.
And have you any idea when the authorities are going to finish their questions?
No idea.
Have the police been also questioning everybody on board?
I have been questioned by the police.
They told us that they were going to talk to everyone on board with a view to seeing if any offences had been committed.
So all they came to see me and I've gave them and there's nothing. There's been no offences on board at all whatsoever.
And as far as you're aware, the police are happy with what you told them, right?
That is true, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
I wanna see.